The Revisionary Podcast with your host, Juan Carlos.
Hello, 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 and welcome to another episode of the Revisionary Podcast. And as always, I'm your host, Juan Carlos. Okay, so if this is your first time ever listening to this podcast, first off, like, subscribe, because it is now your favorite podcast. I'm glad we agree. Thank you for coming. But the way this podcast works is we bring on guests, usually comedians, who tell a nonfiction story about their lives in which they wish things had gone a little bit differently. Afterwards, I give them an opportunity to tell the same exact story, except this time, they can change any facts or details that they would like about the story. So this week, I'm actually really excited because I get to sit down with Sam Morrison. For those of you guys who've never heard of Sam, he's a New York City-based comedian who's been a writer on Blind Date. He's participated in, he was selected as a finalist for Stand Up NBC. And he's also performed on the Tonight Show Showcase. And he's considered one of the top comedians coming out of New York right now. You've probably seen him featured in the New York Times, Time Out, GQ, Vanity Fair, BuzzFeed, National Lampoon. You see what I'm saying? The guy's been everywhere. And if you haven't seen him there, you probably might have possibly... it's within the realm of possibility that you've seen him on the Travel Channel, PBS, or maybe you just randomly heard him on SiriusXM. But either way, it doesn't matter because I get to sit with him and chat with him here on the Revisionary Podcast. So I'm super excited. Quick story. The first time I met Sam, he probably won't remember this, but I was doing an open mic, and I remember it was one of those like open mics in, I want to say, the East Village. And it was one of those where, like, for those of you guys who don't know, we go to open mics to, like, work out material and, you know, get timing. Whenever a joke's new, you know, you kind of have to tell it as many times as possible just to figure out where the funny is. So I was at an open mic, and it was, like, in the back of this bar. And it was weird because you go into the bar, right? And then there's, like, what looks like a hidden door into a whole other room, which was kind of cool. And there must have been, like, 25 to 30 people. Possible, I don't know, maybe up to 40 people on this list. So it was one of those mics that it was really hard to get time on. And everyone who went up only had like 2 minutes to perform. So it was like quick. It was churn and burn them, right? So going one after the other, one after the other, one after the other. And I think they're pulling names from a hat, if I remember correctly. So we're sitting there, and I watch, Sam go up, and he performs. And then, I think there were people who were performing that night whose names were being pulled out of the hat, but they had left because so much time had passed by. I mean, you can imagine, it was like 20 to 40 people, you know, so this thing is taking forever, you know, to get your name called. So I remember they called a name, and they're like, is this person's here? And no one, like, said yes. And Sam goes, yeah, they're here, and points to one of their friends and goes, come here. And we all see them, like, you know, see Sam calling them over because clearly he wanted to get over. It was the first time I'd ever met him. I thought it was hilarious just watching, like, him trying to sneak his friend up on the list. So that is my first impression of Sam. I'm excited. I've seen him perform several times in New York City. Really, really nice guy. And, you know, he's always been very cordial to me, and he is hilarious. Every time I watch him, he makes me laugh hysterically. As a matter of fact, I'm going to tell you a quick story, even though it's not my story to share. But I was actually having a conversation with our audio engineer, Phil. And Phil was telling me a story about how he tried to record a special for Sam. Like, Phil was the film guy, the video guy. And here's the thing about Phil, for those of you guys who haven't been paying attention. Phil is around comedy all the time. His wife is hilarious. Like, you know what I mean? Like, he... It's and like, after a while, you know, you kind of get desensitized to, like, the comedy. Like, you spend enough time around comedians, you know, when something's funny, you go, ha, that's funny. And that's kind of the extent of it. You know, like, yes, sometimes I laugh, but, you know, like, generally it's that, ha, that's funny. Phil apparently, a few times during Sam's special, laughed so hard that he shook the camera. Like, he could not keep still, which is incredible for Phil because, like I said, he's around comedy all the time. So those jokes were really hitting that night. But either way, let me stop hyping this up. I'm real excited. Let's go ahead and get Sam on the line. Hey, Sam, how are you?
What's up, bud? Thank you for having me.
No, absolutely. Thank you for coming on the Revisionary Podcast. All our revisionists are very excited to hear from you.
So this is such a great concept for a podcast.
You know, it's funny. Everyone says that, and I really appreciate it, because I thought long and hard on what I wanted my podcast to be. Like it took me like months of thinking before I finally came down to this concept.
Well, good job. It really is.
So what have you been up to?
Just last Saturday, I did, I love doing these like solo shows.
Right.
So last year I went to Edinburgh and I did, this solo show called Hello Daddy. Mm-hmm. And it was, the short line is about having sex with other people's dads, but it was like, you know, it was a little bit more theater and it was a little more narrative. And my next one, I just put it up on its feet for the first time. It's called Founding Daddies. And it's sort of a historical piece, and it's me. I'm very frustrated that there's no like gay history before Stonewall. It was very difficult to find, and it's nowhere in curriculums. And so it was really me trying to find that history. Mm-hmm. And then writing about how gay Abraham Lincoln is.
Can I be honest with you? I'm actually very embarrassed having this conversation with you right now that I don't even know what Stonewall is. So I feel like I have to go Google that afterwards.
Stonewall is what a lot of people think is the beginning of the gay rights movement. It was, you know, do you know the bar Stonewall Inn? It's in the West Village.
Yes, 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 yes.
Yeah, there was the riots there in the 1960s. And that basically kicked off the gay rights movement. I'm confident there's a better summary of that event.
Of course.
That is the cursory.
Wow.
Definition of it.
See, that's what I'm saying. I didn't even know that was a thing. So clearly curriculums need to be reshaped so that.
Yeah. Right.
Know about these things.
Yeah.
That's wild to me. Okay. Wow. So what else have you been up to? Have you been working on anything creatively? Well, besides those, I mean.
Right. Yeah, that's just really logical work. It's just.
Well, I mean, just it makes sense to me. They should be, you know, you guys are all equal people.
Yeah, exactly. Right. There's a lot of math in the show, surprisingly. I'm kind of always writing a new pilot. I love writing pilots. I am, you know, doing stand up. I host Thrift Shop, which is a weekly stand up show every Friday at Now and Then in the backyard while we still can, while we're outside. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm doing other stuff probably that I can't think of right now.
No, I get it. You probably have a million things going on at any given moment. Are you, and you also come from a theater background, right?
Yeah. I majored in theater in college, which I almost chose as my, shouldn't have done that.
What were your favorite shows that you were a part of? I was a theater kid too, but not in college.
Oh, it makes so much sense. It does, except for not knowing what Stonewall is, but otherwise it does. So a lot of the plays that I put on were like very, that I was in were like, you know, the one mainstream one that I was in was Pippin, but otherwise I was in these weird, cause Cornell was very much about like pedagogical new kinds of theater.
Right.
So I was in a play called The Trestle at Poplick Creek, which I loved. I was in a play called On the Verge. I was in, you know, of course, this like weird adaptation of a Charlie Chaplin film called In the Middle of the Night, which was all physical comedy. I did that my freshman year. That was really cool. Okay. I didn't realize how cool it was until I think later in my life. I don't know. I think I really liked being in The Trestle at Poplick Creek because I got to be this. Oh, I was also in The Complete Works of William Shakespeare Abridged. Do you know that?
No.
Oh my God. Such a fun play. It's, you do every Shakespeare play.
Right.
In like an hour.
Uh-huh.
And of course you like can't do that. They just make fun of every Shakespeare play, but it's just really well written, just satire. It's like if SNL did all of the Shakespeare plays in like an hour.
That's amazing.
Yeah. It's like a cast of five people. And that was the most fun I think I've had doing theater.
I think I might just go ahead and get that script and find a local park and get five of my closest friends and we're just going to make this happen.
Yeah, you should. It's so much fun. And it's so funny too.
Yeah. Wow. That's great. By the way, I didn't know you went to Cornell. My little brother is graduating from Cornell this year. So, you know, go.
No way.
Go Big Red. Yeah. 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 So
what is, well, there's no way I know him. I graduated in 2017.
Okay.
But if he's graduating now, yeah. I was a senior when he was a freshman, probably then.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very proud of him. Although, now that I'm looking at you, he wears the same style of glasses as yours. So maybe it's just a Cornell thing. That's just the Ivy League look.
I know you guys can't see on audio, but I have Ted Bundy glasses. People keep telling me that I'm like gay Ted Bundy. And I'm like, no, he was gay. I'm just Ted Bundy.
That's amazing. Why don't we go ahead and get into this. Sam, the stage is yours. Go ahead and tell us your story.
Great. I'm so excited because I haven't told this story before and right. I haven't planned it out at all. So it's,
perfect.
It's going to be pure impulse.
Okay.
Okay. So I guess maybe sometime last year, my good friend Isabel Hagen asked me to open for her. She's doing this very cool combination because she is a very talented musician who went to Juilliard, but is also a very talented stand-up comedian and wow. is professional in both of those worlds.
That's not fair.
It's not fair. It's not. It's insane. I don't know if there's anyone else like that. It's like so unique and so cool. That's the thing I wish I did differently is I just wish that I was Isabel.
Done. All right.
Yeah, done. So she like finally brought the two together right. in just a night at the Crane Theater, but it was, you know, I think it was her doing like, it was like 45 minutes and all of her friends and family were there and it was packed down and she asked me to open for her. And I was like, oh my God, of course I'd love to. And then, so the day of, I think I'm coming from work. I don't remember. I have a vague memory of being in like professional clothes and I, my phone is running out of battery. I worked at this like a contact lens company where I would just ingest basically doctor's notes and quality control check them. And, I left work to go to Isabel, to go to Isabel's show. And I remember I actually don't remember if I was coming from work, because now I'm remembering maybe I came in from out of town. Anyway, the point is that I am running late and my phone battery is low and I'm on the train and I have to I have to poop.
Okay.
I don't know how else to put it.
Yeah, of course.
And I'm like, but I can't because I can't, like, you know, because when you're on the subway and you have to poop. I don't know if this has happened to you or if this happens to other people,
right.
but it's like you to get off to find some bodega with a bathroom that they yeah. let you use and you have to buy a piece of pizza or whatever and then get back on. That's going to ruin your commute.
I mean, Sam, you know, it is New York City. There are tons of homeless people who just squat in a corner of the subway car.
I know, but I'm not homeless and I'm gay. So I don't know if I can do that.
That's fair. You know what? That's fair. I don't have those experiences.
Just to be clear, have you done that?
Absolutely not. But don't think that I haven't stumbled upon it and you go, you know what? Sometimes you just gotta go. But so I have myself.
What do you do if you have to poop on the subway? You have to hold it in until you get to your destination.
Right. No, absolutely.
Which for me was like 3 or 4 subway stops.
Okay, that's close. But
here's the thing is I should have, because I really had to go and okay, some of you are ahead of me and can kind of see where this is going. Yes, this is a story about pooping myself.
Okay.
So I get off the train and my phone is, has run out of battery. At the time, I remember my phone is like so broken. It was running out of battery so quickly. It was just really old and just ran out of battery really easily. I have no idea why, but it was broken and I got it fixed soon after, but my phone had run out of battery. So now I got off the subway and I needed to be like on stage in like 5 minutes.
Okay.
And, but I, you know, in a normal situation, I would just like text Isabel and be like, I'm so sorry. I'm running 5 minutes late, 5 minutes late. I'll be there right as soon as possible. But instead I'm like, I gotta hold it in and get to the show. It's like, it's her big show and
right,
she doesn't know I'm coming late. And like, I mean, if you are have to start on a theater at 7 PM and your openers and they're at 7:05, she's probably freaking out or trying to find another friend that can open for her
right
or whatever. Anyway, I start running.
Which seems like a terrible idea, by the way, but go on.
Right, right. Because when you run, it actually makes it harder to hold in, right? Well, I guess I know that now. So I start running down the streets of New York City towards the Crane Theater. Just with the most clenched asshole of 2019.
Right.
And it's, I'm not going to make it. And I see a, what are those coffee shops?
Starbucks?
No, you asshole. I think it was a Bean Cafe.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And I just run into the side door and go straight to the bathroom and it's locked. There's somebody in the bathroom. And I fully poop myself on the outside of the bathroom in this Bean Cafe.
Oh my God.
Is poop coming out of my butthole down the back of my thigh.
Oh no.
And I'm just staring out at these like room of nice white hipsters as they work, just like hoping they don't look at me or notice what's going on as I have like a deeply furrowed brow and poop rolling down the back of my thigh. And, you know, I'm trying to put my legs together to like keep it from coming out more. And it's so clear what's going on.
Oh, no.
So the person eventually comes out and I eventually go into the bathroom just to clean up.
Right. Cause at this point you don't have to go anymore.
At this point, there's nothing else there for me to do in that bathroom. So I like clean up as best I can, but still very hurriedly. But the thing is once you like take off poopy pants, the
oh my God.
Isn't poopy pants such a fun word? Once you take them off, you don't realize how much worse it is to put them back onto your body after you've cleaned up. You know?
Yeah, what,
if you poop yourself in pants and walk around with the poop in the pants, somehow that's better than pooping yourself, cleaning your butthole off, and then
putting the... I have a question.
Sorry, am I being too vivid?
No, not at all. Look, details are key here. But here's what I'm trying to figure out. How tight were your pants? Because it's a whole different scenario if it's like loose and it can fall out versus a tight seal.
Great question. I don't remember, but there was not like poop falling out.
Okay.
I think that's right. I was probably wearing skinny jeans. I mostly wear skinny jeans, and so the pant was probably smushing the poop against the butt enough that it would not fall down and was sort of pancaking, if you will.
Right.
So I am in the bathroom and I am like, what am I going to do? I refuse to put these poopy pants back on, but I do. I'm like, okay, here's my plan. And I Google for like a clothing store nearby and I find that there's a Buffalo Exchange like three blocks away.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay, I can do this. And at this point it's like, 7:10 PM. And so I put the poopy pants back on and I run to Buffalo Exchange, which now I've got Now it's like, it's middle of summer, right? It's right. Like now I'm running in New York City again with poop just drying on my thigh.
You're probably all sweaty too. Oh man, that's gross.
Oh, and I'm all sweaty. It's the grossest thing you could imagine. And I make it to Buffalo Exchange and I just grab two pants.
Right.
Or no, I grab one pair of pants and just doesn't matter which and go to the changing room. And they like don't fit at all. So I have to.
Hold on. How are you trying on pants with like smeared poop all over your thighs?
Yeah, we're going to move past that. So.
Oh my God. Okay.
Deeply unethical. Well, here's the thing though, is I planned on buying whatever I was trying on. I was not going to start trying on pants for fit, you know? Right. So I try these pants on and they don't fit. Like I can't even get them on. And so I have to once again, put the poopy pants back on to go back out into Buffalo Exchange to find another pair of pants. I find another pair of pants, go back there, put those pants of pants on, they fit. And then I go to check out and they're like, we have to get the thing off of these pants before you can leave. The security tag.
Right.
And it's like very awkward to get the security tag off the pants. They're like, we need you to go back and change out of them so that we can get the security tag off. And I was just like, no, I will not.
Go on.
And they were like, why? And I was like, you don't have to know. I'm not going back there. You're taking them off. And so they're like, okay, dude, whatever. You're weird. So what they had to do is they had to like throw my thigh up onto the table to get it at the right angle underneath the tag remover so that it could slide across. And it's not working. They had to get like three employees to come over. Not making this up. Oh, man, this story is so good. I have no idea.
I'm so embarrassed for you. Because in my head right now, what I'm imagining you is like doing that thing, you know, that the ballerinas do with one leg up on the bar?
Yes.
That's what I'm picturing.
That's exactly correct. And I'm like I don't have good balance. So I'm like falling over as these, like one person has to like hold me and then another person has to like try to angle the leg at the right way to like unslide the security tag. Finally, they get the security tag off, and I'm just like, here's $40, goodbye. And while they were like, you can't leave, you need to take that security tag off, you need to go back and change out of those pants. I remember at one point, I screamed like, I can't, I have to be on the stage in 5 minutes. It's just so funny to me.
So pretentious, I love it.
Just the most NYU theater fag thing you can do. Just like, excuse me, I have to be on stage in 5 minutes. How dare you? Remove this security tag at once.
Right.
And so in full sweats in my new pair of jeans that, by the way, don't fit at all. Like, we're way too big. But I had a belt, so I like put them around my belt. I look ridiculous. I run into the Crane Theater.
Right.
And so I run into backstage and I see Isabel just as calmly as possible sitting there. And I'm like, I'm so sorry I'm late. And she's like, oh no, it's fine. We haven't started yet. And I'm just like, and you know, I'm coming in like full anxiety.
Yeah.
She's so calm and wasn't worried about anything, or at least was pretending to not be worried about anything.
Right.
And I go on stage and I have like a fine set with mind you, a backpack of poop pants in the back.
Why? Why did you throw them out?
Yeah, no, great question. Great question. I did when I got back, but I, for some reason, didn't want to throw these pants away because I guess they're my favorite skinny jeans. I don't know. I wasn't thinking.
Okay, so I have another question for you, Sam.
Oh, this story is so not over.
No, I'm glad. Good. I'm glad this isn't over, but hold on, quick recess for this. So now you're sitting there, you know, you're doing the plie or whatever it is, it's called, the beret. I don't know what it's called. I don't listen to ballet or follow it. How are people not smelling you right now?
I don't know. I have no idea. Maybe they did. Okay. I have no idea. Okay. I mean, I tried. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, because the poop pants were in a plastic bag in my backpack.
Right.
And I had supposedly cleaned myself off in this bean cafe.
Right. As well as you could.
As well as I could. And I had these new pair of jeans on. So hopefully, I don't know. I bet they did. I mean, luckily there weren't many people in the Buffalo Exchange, if any. Right. Yeah. So the show actually went fine. I mean, like, I, considering everything, I had a fine set.
Right.
And I got off stage and then, so I'm seeing this guy who is now like my boyfriend, and we've been together for, like 2.5 years now. And, thank you. And, but at the time we hadn't been together for that long. Mm-hmm. We had been together for a not long enough time to bring a backpack of shitty pants back to his place. Because I was going back over to his place. I had the backpack and I almost forgot because it went well. And I was watching Isabel's set and I was so enamored by her performance and her thing was going so well with her whole family. And like, I met a lot of different people and then we went back to my boyfriend's place. And I like forgot that I had this and I just had to tell him that I had this like bag. And I mean, he was, I think, understanding and empathetic of the situation. I mean, now I would literally poop on his face. Like, I don't care.
Right.
But at that point, I think it was a little weird.
Of course.
And I guess that's the end of the story. Is that a story? I mean,
it is certainly a story. It's wild.
I mean, it has a beginning, a middle, and end. Right?
It does. It has a climax, which is you like eagle spread
on. Oh man, this isn't public, is it?
What do you mean? Like, are people listening right now?
No, this is never going to be released, right?
Oh, yeah, no, clearly, you know, just, you know, maybe 600 to 700 of my closest fans and, you know, might hear this, but that's it, just a small amount.
Good, yeah.
So, wow, hold on, okay, let's recollect here.
Yeah, please.
So, I guess a lot of my questions are really related around the smell, because this is where I'm concerned, because I'm trying to figure out how you wipe yourself well enough for people not to smell. So there's you removing the tag. Then there's like, you're talking about how you're networking with me. How are you networking and like possibly smelly? Like, how's that going?
Okay. Great question. And I want you to keep in mind that this is one of the lowest moments of my life.
Fair enough.
I do not stand by anything
okay.
happened that night, and it is deeply embarrassing.
Fair.
With that being said, these are fantastic questions. I don't really know. I know that once I got like as many steps as I could, I was trying to contain the situation. So when I got to the crane, before I went on stage, just given multiple wipes down to make sure there was no extra poop in, you know, the butthole hairs or and such.
Right.
And making sure that I wash my hands thoroughly. And you know, once I sort of was able to quarantine the actual poop pants into the clutch thing was in a plastic bag that I like tied around. So maybe that was able to contain the smell.
Right.
And the other thing is maybe I just have like such good hygiene that my poops don't smell and I'm just a little angel.
Yeah, that is very possible. I'm also going to throw out there or float out the theory that you maybe just have really good friends who were kind enough to just ignore it.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
I'm sure. I was not networking, to be very clear.
Okay.
I was avoiding as many social interactions as I possibly could. I guess I did watch Isabel show. But I was also backstage, if I remember correctly. And no, maybe I wasn't. I don't know. But I basically, like, it was her show, and I watched it, and then I mean, I got out of there kind of as soon as I could without being rude. Obviously, nobody knew what was going on. And I did tell Isabel about this later, and she was like, I had no idea.
That's good.
Which is a testament to the smell.
Right.
Because,
right.
I mean, if I come back to a green room smelling, I think the first thing you would do is be like, Sam, you smell.
I mean, look, Sam, I've hung around enough comedians in green rooms that sometimes I know that's just how comedians smell. So I kind of.
That's
just
right. That's back. Right. I was just trying to be more of like a real New York stand-up comedian.
Got it. Going for the whole experience. No, I get it.
Yes.
So let's go ahead and. Oh my
God. Any more questions, or are we all clear?
No. We're very clear on the smell here. So let's go. Go ahead and go back into this, Sam, and go ahead and retell us your story with your new changes.
Okay, so I just tell it like I am telling it for the first time.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's do it.
Great. So I'm coming from my work, which, by the way, I am a writer for Marvelous Miss Maisel.
Oh, I did not know that. That's amazing. I love that show.
Oh, no, I'm lying.
No, I'm playing along.
Oh, okay, good. You're a very good actor.
Thank you.
Do you have a background in theater?
Maybe. You know, I peaked in high school, so I don't want to talk about it, but go on.
Same. Writer for Marvelous Miss Maisel, and then I went on to my open for my friend Isabel, and all her friends and family were going to be there at this big show where she was combining her music and her comedy. And I get on the train and I realize that I have to poop, and I get off the train and I poop, and then I go open for Isabel. Is that too easy?
Yeah, it's a little too easy. Also, by the way, as I pointed out before, you know, you kind of like stuck your nose up at it, but you did have the option of just going in a corner of the train. That was always an option. You know, you were like, I'm not homeless, I'm better than that. But you chose dirty pants all night over the homeless look.
Man, you're really pushing for the homeless poop.
Yeah, you know, you're right. That is a little pushy. I'm sorry.
It's weird that you had so many questions about like the smell, but you were you're like, why didn't you just poop on the subway?
You're right. That is weird. I don't know why, but okay.
So then I held it in successfully because I have such good discipline and self-control. And then I got off the subway and my phone died, but I have one of those phone battery portable ones.
Yeah.
And I plugged my phone in, and it reawoke. What is the correct word? My phone. Mm-hmm. And I believe the correct word is turned on. It enlivened my phone. Every sentence is a performance. And I texted Isabel and I said, I'm so sorry. I'm running a couple minutes late. And she said, oh my God, no problem. You're so hot and talented.
Right.
And I said, thank you. I'm also humble. And then I ran to Bean Cafe.
You still go to a Bean Cafe. We haven't upgraded to a Starbucks here. Okay, go on.
I go to a Bean Cafe, yeah. And I wait for my turn to use the bathroom. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, poop on one of the customers. I think part of the reason I didn't do it in the original story, or I had to put myself in the original story, is because the guy in there was taking so long. And if you know anything about East Village bathrooms, half the time there's someone in the bathroom, it's because they're doing drugs and they're in there for like hours.
I did not know that.
I mean, it it's just a, yeah, it, I think that's true.
Now, look, it's interesting, because let me ask you something else. So, because you did mention how you were running, right? And we both agreed how running probably made it way worse.
Yes.
Would you have walked in your...
I would have so calmly walked, knowing that I had that buffer time from Isabel, just strolling down the street with listening to music. And then once I got to the Bean Cafe, understanding the situation, I would have knocked on the door a couple more times and not waited for the person. Because I think he did take like 10 minutes to come out, and that was part of the problem.
Got it.
And the whole time I was like, should I go try to find another bathroom? It's so hard to find a bathroom around here. Should I just wait? I should just wait. He'll probably be out anytime soon. Mm-hmm. So I knocked on the door several times, and the person came out. And I used the bathroom very adult-like.
So, and it, oh, go ahead.
No, nothing.
No, I was going to say, so let me ask you this, Sam. Let's say, you know, the story had happened, you poop your pants, right? What would you have changed about your actions at Buffalo Exchange?
Yeah, so assuming I did poop my pants?
Yeah, you did.
So I poop. Okay. So I poop my pants, and then I go to Buffalo Exchange.
Right.
And I pick out a pair of jeans, which I do not try on. Mm-hmm. No, I do need to get them on my body somehow, though, right? To get to the show, because I don't want to go to the show with poopy pants and then have to
change there.
Or worse things worse, like I go to the show and she's like, you got to be on stage now. And then I have to go on with poopy pants. What a conundrum.
Yes. Yeah, so walk me through this. How would this go?
So I think I would still have to pick up, but I would make sure to get the correct pair of pants. In fact, I would go oversized so I wouldn't have to go back out, mm-hmm, because I knew I had a belt.
Right.
So get an oversized pair of pants, and I go into the dressing room, and I would try it on. I would buy the pair of pants first, and then I would go into the dressing room and put them on, and then I would leave.
So you might have walked out with like four different pairs of pants. You know that, right?
No, I would make sure I got the correct one.
Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
So,
and then I would go and open for Isabel. And
is there any world where you go through this but decide to save yourself the $40 in an effort to just get there sooner?
Like, don't try to buy a new pair of pants?
Yeah, just you know, hope for the best in your current situation.
Great question. Decidedly no.
Okay, no, that's fine.
I don't think there's any way to go there with the pants, with the poopy pants. Mm-hmm. I think that's too risky to walk into a room with poopy pants, because you can't mask that smell.
Yeah.
And also to perform in that, I would never be able to do that. I would need another pair of pants somehow. I mean, okay, maybe, you know, I could call a friend or something. I don't know. Maybe I could, I don't know.
I'm going to share a counter story with you really quickly, because I had a somewhat different but somewhat similar situation.
Oh my God. Thank God. Yeah. People listening, if you want to just send me your stories in solidarity, I would really appreciate that.
No, please do. And definitely, you know, follow Sam and, you know, and reach out. So it was actually performing, it was at Marcus Cardona had a show in Brooklyn.
Uh-huh.
And I go to perform, you know, everything's perfect. I drove because I, you know, just drive all over New York City because I don't know, that's just my thing.
Yeah.
Find the perfect parking spot. Everything's going great. Open my car door, and the moment I stepped out, my pants rip across the crotch.
Yes, good. Like, yes.
It's the middle of winter, so I think it's like mid-December, and I'm just freeballing all over in Brooklyn, right?
Do you have underwear, though?
Yes, but I'm wearing like, you know, those tight, modely underwear that you see on billboards? Yeah, so it was laundry day, so nothing's hidden, if you get what I'm saying. It's just really,
wow.
Real tight. And much like you, I also ran into a Buffalo Exchange. Problem is, I'm rolling in with a very visible rip. There's nobody but like me and the woman working the counter. And it's this very awkward exchange where I'm just walking in like, look, I need pants. And she's trying very hard to keep her eyes above my shoulder line. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I could not find pants, but I was also running late. The place where we were performing was literally right next door, so it wasn't like that big a deal. But I was, you know, like 15 minutes late at this point. I hit traffic on the BQE. It happens. You know, I'm going through different pants. Problem is, I'm a big guy. So Sam is over here talking about finding bigger pants. But what Sam considers bigger pants wouldn't fit one of my thighs. So my problem was I couldn't find pants that fit me, period.
Yeah.
Unless there were like pants from like the early 2000s, you know what I mean? Those ugly, ugly, like
some JNCO jeans.
Kind of, actually. That was the kind. So I'm searching for a while. I could not find pants.
Finally, oh no! In Buffalo Exchange, do they not have a wide selection of pants?
They do if you're smaller. That's what I'm telling you. Big, not for bigger guys.
Yeah.
So it's like sometimes I could find stuff that fit my waist, but then they were too short, you know, because I'm also a little on the taller side. So, you know, I couldn't find anything that both covered my ankles and fit my waist. Mm-hmm. Finally, I find these like old, like acid wash, like, you know, Zach Morris type pants.
Yes.
And I fit into, but they're super tight. Like the button looks like if I sneeze even a little bit, it's just shooting off. You know what I mean? It's like, it's like barely fitting. Like, I'm just like, it's one of those where like, I'm trying not to move too much because of the compromising situation I'm in.
And did your friend say anything? Were they like, whoa, cool pants?
I mean, look, no one said anything. Thankfully, right? It was dark. I want to point out that I made a mistake. This was like at a bar. And they sold, like, it was some really cool bar, but they sold, like, Chinese food in the back. And I made the mistake of buying food. Boy, did I regret that, because it made the pants feel that much more tighter, because I thought, oh, when I'm on stage. And then I proceeded to go have one of my, like, one of the most epic bombs that I've had.
Oh, no.
In New York City. With those pants on. It was, like, that pants energy. While I'm safe,
well, so you just can't have like confidence in those kind of pants.
No,
you know, you know, everyone's looking at your pants, or at least you have that insecurity in your mind.
I mean, I think that was a huge part of it. It was just, there was a dog in the bar at the same time. I'm afraid of dogs. I was like, I don't know what's going on right now. This is just not okay. So yeah, that was my story. Not as bad, but you know, similar.
L'chaim, we are brothers.
No, I guess so. Okay, so but before I let you go, do you have any last words for our revisionaries?
Last words?
Yeah, in case they never hear from you ever again.
I go. Be yourself. Those are my last words.
Yeah, love yourself. I get it. You know, self-care, right, Sam?
Yeah, that's what my brand's all about.
Self-care, loving yourself. Okay, and we have a tradition on this podcast where, well, we have two traditions. The first is we like to end every episode by asking our guests to please share a very happy childhood story that puts a smile on their face or just, you know, fills them up with warmth inside.
Delicious. Okay, I know I'm a normal human, and I feel a necessity to prove that after my very abnormal story.
Right.
I'm going to say, oh, yes. It's a little, it was after my parents got divorced, and my mom, who was very strict and like never wanted us to do drugs or alcohol, with my sister and my brother, she like took shots with us.
Nice.
And we just laughed like all night in the middle of this, like, you know, traumatizing event, but it was really nice.
Yeah. See what I mean? Heartwarming. That's a nice story.
Yeah. See, I have emotions in somewhat normal experiences.
No, absolutely. And lastly, we also have another tradition where we like to highlight and support some organization or charity. Do you have one for us that you'd like to talk
about? Yeah, Critical Resistance. They are all about prison abolition. And I think that that's so important. I've sort of never believed in prisons, or at least the way that we think about them. And they really work to like normalize the idea that we don't need prisons, and that like our modern conception of prisons is not normal and is really bad and dangerous and ineffective and kind of pointless. They don't really do anything. So yeah, they do a lot of good. They do a lot of good like information dissemination. They have a lot of good graphics, like introduce people to the idea of prison abolition. So go check them out.
Perfect. Would you be willing to provide us with the link so I can put it down in the description?
Yeah, for sure.
All right, great. And lastly, Sam, where can we follow you?
You can follow me on at Samuel H. Morrison on Instagram and Twitter. And if you go to my website and you live in New York City and you want to catch a show, you can go to my website and you can put your email in there. I have a newsletter where I send out like free or discounted tickets when I have a big show coming up, whether I'm like headlining or doing a new solo show or just like a big showcase.
And if you guys mentioned to Sam that you heard of him on this podcast, he might pretend to remember that he knows what this podcast was. But we're going to move on.
Yeah, I have already repressed this podcast.
Understandably so. No, I mean, look, like I said, it happens to all of us. I feel like you can't live in New York City without having one of these stories, whether it is you throwing up all over yourself or you, you know, getting on the subway, having to use the bathroom, and you have an hour subway. It happens to everybody. It's like part of the
experience. Really does.
Thank you so much for coming on the podcast, Sam. We want to say goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. The
Revisionary Podcast. So, about that. Honestly, I did not know what I was walking into this phone call, but that's just a very unfortunate event. My question is, like, I don't know how more people didn't pick up the scent or the whiff or, like, I don't know. So, I find that to be, wow. Okay. Well, you know, I want to say shout out to Sam and thank you for being vulnerable and sharing that story with us. I really appreciate it. And I want to thank you for, spending time with us on the Revisionary Podcast. I'm sure our revisionaries enjoyed listening and hearing from you. And honestly, on that note, as I always say, revisionaries, thank you for listening. This is